Continuing with our discussion of ggplot, we'll now look at various techniques to visualize the distribution of various data sets. Okay, so here we are again revisiting our MPG data frame, which is built into ggplot. So we execute this command ggplot MPG, which is the data set we are going to use for the plot. And then we are mentioning the aesthetics that we are going to be using. And we've chosen to mention the aesthetics right in the call to ggplot. We could very well have done that in the geom, but in this case, we have chosen to do it like this. And you know that the first argument to ggplot is the data argument, so I can give it as an unnamed argument MPG. The second argument to ggplot is the mapping argument, that is mapping of the characteristics of the data to the characteristics of the plot. That is the second argument. Therefore, again, I am not saying mapping equals AES, etc. So that's what we are doing. And the first two arguments to the aesthetics function are really the X and Y mappings. So once again, I'm able to say AES DRV, HWY, which is the kind of drive that the car has and the highway mileage it provides. So again, I'm providing them as unnamed arguments because the first is X, the second is Y. Okay, so what we're really trying to do here is saying on the x-axis, put the drive of a car, on the y-axis, put its highway mileage, and give me a scatter plot, because we are saying geom point. Okay, so all of this will be familiar to you from prior work that you've done. And this gives us the following plot. Now, we know that the data set has three values for drive, four-wheel drive, front-wheel drive, and rear-wheel drive. Those are the three values for drive, and therefore you just see 3 points on the x-axis. And of course, we've got lots of variations of highway mileage, so we see that. Okay, but again, it's a little interesting because our data set has, I think, almost 400 rows of data, but we are seeing a very small number of data points that are shown in the plot. Okay, and that is happening because, of course, there's a lot of overplotting going on. And that is because in this data set, the highway mileage is recorded, I think, to the nearest quarter of miles per gallon or half of a miles per gallon, whatever it is. But it's all rounded in those points. And therefore, you're seeing the points at discrete positions. Okay. And of course, therefore, if you've got a four-wheel drive and several cars that have, let's say, 20 miles per gallon, then all of those points are going to be plotted as just one single point. It's not one single point, it's actually many points plotted one on top of the other. Finally, what we are seeing is the last one plotted. Okay, so there's a lot of overplotting going on. And from our discussion earlier about positioning, you already know how to handle this. You can say jitter it by doing geom jitter. Now notice that in this plot, I'm showing you yet another technique that you can use with ggplot. So here we've got the ggplot call, ggplot MPG AES DRV HWY. So we've got that call and we are storing that in a variable g, right? Notice that in this particular call, there is no geom that we have assigned to this plot, right? So if we did execute this plot, we would see nothing, right? Because there is no geom to be shown. So you'll get an empty plot, okay? But what we are doing here is storing that in a variable. So obviously the system would not even try to plot it because we're putting it in a variable. And then we can actually do the plotting by using that variable and just adding whatever geoms we need. So if you execute this line of code, what you get, of course, is this plot. So what has happened is that we have told our ggplot to jitter every point. Okay. So all of these points that we are seeing here in this region, all of these points were overplotted as on one single line. Okay. So that's why you saw only a small set of points here. But now that we have jittered them, we know that jittering works by adding a small amount of random noise to each point, okay, random noise on the x-axis and on the y-axis, and so the points get separated, right? Because it's random noise, points will be jittered differently, each point will be jittered differently, and so we'll start seeing the separation between the points. So that's what we are seeing here. So the random noise has separated out these points which appear to be plotted, overplotted earlier. So this is one way to look at how the highway mileage is distributed for cars with different kinds of drive. But of course, this ought to have reminded you of something else that we've already done. And so that is the following. So again, we're doing storing this base characteristics of the plot, the data and the basic mappings in the variable called g. And now we are doing g plus geom box plot. Okay, so we are preparing a box plot. Of course, if you look at the previous slide, it sort of looked like a box plot, except that there was no box, there was no median, but the values look like boxes kept in a box. So that's what you're seeing here. So now we are getting a typical box plot, and you already know how to interpret this box plot. Okay, so this box plot looks a little different from the one that we got when we used base graphics. The only difference really is that in base graphics, at the extremes of the two lines, there would be horizontal lines, and that's not shown here, that's all. Okay, so the outliers are shown just like before. They're dots either above or below on the upper side or on the lower side. That's all fine. Okay, so that's how you do a box plot. Now, the interesting thing about box plot is that when we did base graphics, we were able to create a box plot by specifying just one variable. And in fact, we were able to create a box plot for a single variable. Okay, with ggplot, creating a box plot for a single variable, that is just specifying one quantitative variable, is actually quite tricky, and we'll look at that shortly. So that is why you've got here the mapping with both the aesthetics, right? You've got an X mapping and a Y mapping. Typically, with base graphics, just an X mapping alone would have sufficed, but that's not how ggplot works. Okay, so with ggplot, you have to supply both an X and a Y mapping for drawing box plots. So the obvious question that arises is, what do I do if I've got just one box plot to be plotted? I'm plotting just one variable. We'll come to that shortly. Okay, now sometimes when you're doing box plots, you would like to see the box to be horizontal and not vertical. And in general, you may want to flip around box plots, histograms, bar plots, so many other things, in which you don't want the box or the bar to be vertical. Instead, you might want it to be horizontal sometimes. It's very easy to achieve that by just doing coord flip. You're flipping the coordinates. So when you do that, you get the same plot, but it looks like this. Okay? Notice that when you do a coord flip, what it's doing is generating the plot and then flipping it around. Okay? So it doesn't mean that the X and Y mappings have changed. Notice the X mapping is still drive. Y mapping is still highway, although drive now seems to appear on the Y axis. That is because we flipped the coordinates. Notice that coordinate flipping is only for display purposes. It doesn't change anything about the mappings. That is something which is important to understand. Okay, so here I'm revisiting the difference between base graphics and ggplot when it comes to plotting a box plot of a single variable. So notice here in ggplot, in base plot, we were able to say something like box plot mpg$hwy. You'd be able to do this. Okay, if ggplot is loaded, the mpg data frame is available, so you can just do mpg$highway and you will get this. Okay, if you want to replicate this graph in ggplot, you may try to do it like this: ggplot mpg aeshwy, right? Because we want only the highway mileage, nothing else. So you may try to do it like this, plus box plot. Okay, this won't work because, as I've already told you, box plot in ggplot requires us to map two aesthetics. Here we have mapped only one aesthetic. Okay, that's a problem. And also, of course, putting highway mileage on the x-axis is a problem because highway mileage is actually appearing on the y-axis. Okay, so you can clearly see that. Okay, so we'll see what to do about this. So when you do this, it says error stat box plot requires the following missing aesthetics y. Okay, because hwy got mapped to x, y aesthetic was not even mapped, so it's complaining because box plot wants us to map both the aesthetics. Okay, and in addition, some other warnings, we can forget it. Okay, so it's saying continuous x aesthetic, did you forget the group aspect? Okay, so that's the way it's working. So what it's basically telling us here is, well, you're using a continuous x aesthetic on a box plot Whereas on a box plot, the x aesthetic cannot be continuous. It has to be discrete, just like here in our current plot, you know, four-wheel drive, front-wheel drive, rear-wheel drive, distinct, you know, discrete. That's what it's supposed to be. So the system is sort of giving us a helpful hint saying, this is a box plot and you're trying to use a continuous x aesthetic. Did you forget something? Okay, so that's what it's trying to tell us. Okay, so if we did this instead, okay, if we said, okay, let's try assigning highway miles to just the Y, map only the Y aesthetic. And then, of course, it comes back and says, I want the X aesthetic, right? So clearly, by all this experimentation, we found out that box plot requires us to mention both the X and the Y aesthetics, right? But the problem is, if you look at the chart, what are we going to put on the X here, right? There's really nothing we can put on the X axis, right? Because really we want the whole data to be plotted as a box plot. Okay, so on the x axis there is really nothing for us to put there. So that's what's going on here, right? So the way to achieve that is the following. Say ggplot mpg aesthetic x equals 1. Okay, now what this does is this tells the system that I want you to do the box plot of the entire data. Okay, if you put x equals any constant value, it doesn't have to be 1, it can be 5, it can be 20, or it can be some string constant, anything constant, if you put in there, then it works. Okay, of course, the x label comes out a little crazy, it says 1, but we can fix that by controlling the labels, as we'll see. You know, there's a function called xlab, we can call that function and just put in whatever we want on the x-axis, or we can just suppress the label on the x-axis altogether. Okay, so that's the important point here. That if you're doing a box plot of a single variable, which we will not be doing often, but if you're doing that, then this is what you will have to do to achieve that with ggplot.